Hi there, I am Dr. Bhagyalakshmi, HOD, Obs and Gyn, Yashoda Hospital, Secunderabad. Today we'll enlighten about a few points on fibroids and prolapse in women, which are very common problems a woman faces. Fibroids is a very common complication a woman faces. The olden days, it used to be said that fibroids come after a woman crosses around 35 years. It's more between 35 and 45 years. But unfortunately, today we are seeing more often fibroids in even younger women and also in postmenopausal women. Even young teenagers are affected with fibroids. With menstrual, they come with a few menstrual disturbance, and when we investigate, we find that they are also suffering from fibroids. So it is not specific to any specific age group, though it is more common in their 30s and 40s. But teenagers and 20s, 50s, 60s, all age groups are nowadays affected with fibroids. Uterine fibroids, all fibroids may not be symptomatic. Sometimes fibroids are diagnosed on routine examination or when a woman comes with some other complaints. When we are doing an ultrasound, fibroids may be diagnosed. So all persons suffering with fibroids need not undergo any specific treatment. The treatment depends upon the size of the fibroids, the number of fibroids, the position of fibroids, and the complaints with which they come from. If they are silent fibroids, less than 5 cm, not interfering at all with a woman's day-to-day activity, it need not be treated, but she has to be kept under observation. We repeatedly scan a woman once in 3 months, 6 months or 9 months, or whenever some symptoms appear, we will do an ultrasound and then see if the fibroid has increased in size. If the fibroid has increased in size, then we need to treat. There are some silent fibroids, as fibroid which is growing on the outer side of the uterus. If it is small, it will not cause any symptoms and it can be just kept under observation. But there are some people who come with lot of complaints like heavy bleeding, painful bleeding, infertility. In such patients, the fibroids need to be treated depending on the age, depending on the symptoms and how we can relieve the symptoms. There are medical managements and surgical managements. See, whether it is COVID-19 or non-COVID-19, fibroids can be diagnosed depending on their symptoms and sometimes on the signs that we elicit. Symptoms include heavy bleeding, painful bleeding, or some patients do not have a bleeding problem but they are not able to conceive in spite of all other factors being normal. So a fibroid may cause infertility, it can cause menstrual disturbance. Some people come with anemia and when we start investigating them, we realize that they have fibroids. Sometimes they come with severe pain when the fibroid is undergoing some degenerative change. And sometimes they also come with pressure symptoms. When the fibroid is growing on the outer side of the uterus, if it is on the front of the uterus, pressing on the bladder, then they complain of urine disturbance. Either they are not able to pass urine or they have to pass more frequently, but they do not empty their bladder completely. If the fibroid is on the back side of the uterus, it can cause pressure on the rectum and it may cause difficulty in passing motion. If it is on the side of the uterus, pressing on the ureters, it can cause changes in the kidneys and it can cause some kidney problems. So that is how we will be diagnosing the fibroids. If the fibroid size is small, the symptoms are not very severe, if she is not becoming anemic, if it is not interfering with her day-to-day life, and if it's only a little bit of menstrual disturbance, then we give them medications to decrease the blood loss and decrease the pain and try not to do any surgical procedures during this COVID-19 period. But if the fibroid is big or suddenly growing very big, causing severe symptoms, then she definitely has to go to the hospital, see the doctor, and if medical management can be done, then it will be done. Otherwise, sometimes, unfortunately, we will still have to go for a surgical intervention. Most often, uterine fibroids cause anemia because of excessive bleeding, and particularly Indian women just ignore their blood loss and go about doing their day-to-day activities. In younger girls, it can cause severe pain, it can cause a bump in the abdomen, it can cause pressure symptoms, then they come to us and that is how we diagnose. Some people come to us because they are not able to conceive, and then when we investigate, then there are no other cause except fibroids. If it is impinging onto the inner side of the uterus, or if it is blocking the tubes, then it causes infertility. In elderly people, generally they suddenly come saying that the abdomen is increasing in girth, and then we see huge fibroids, almost as big as 10 centimeters and 12 centimeters fibroids can be seen. They just come with the complaint of increasing abdominal girth. So that is how, when we start investigating, we are able to find the fibroid. Fibroids sometimes suddenly grow in size, and it can undergo sarcomatous change. Sarcomatous change is one type of a malignant change. Now this can spread to other organs also. So whenever a fibroid suddenly increases in size, then it can form a sarcomatous change. So you have to keep a close watch. So it can cause anemia, it can cause infertility. Anemia to an extent that they become 4 grams, 5 grams hemoglobin, and then they almost come in failure. So it can cause anemia, it can cause failure, it can cause infertility, it can cause precious symptoms, co-impacted feces. Sometimes they come with a sarcomatous change. So these are all the complications that we see with fibroids. Some degenerative changes also can happen, particularly if a woman is pregnant and she is also having fibroids. It can undergo what is called as a red degeneration, which can cause severe pain, fever, and then we only give a conservative management and generally it subsides. And if a woman is having fibroid in pregnancy, then if it grow, it has a chance of growing much bigger during pregnancy because of the increased hormones. It can cause difficulty. First of all, it can cause abortions, and sometimes it can cause premature deliveries, and sometimes at the time of delivery the uterus may not retract, and it can cause heavy bleeding called postpartum hemorrhage, which is a very difficult situation, which is a life-threatening situation for the mother. The uterus is actually like a hammock. It is actually like a jhula, which is suspended by many ligaments. So we have ligaments in the front, ligaments at the back, and ligaments at the side, which holds the uterus in position. So whenever the uterus, the ligaments supporting the uterus become stretched and they don't go back to the normal size, then the uterus starts moving downwards. So whenever the uterus slides downwards, it is called a prolapse. So it can be different degrees of prolapse. It can slide down but still stay within the vagina, or it can come at the level of the introitus, or sometimes the uterus can come outside the introitus, outside the vagina. So these are the different types of prolapse that we see, and it can cause a lot of inconvenience to the woman. Uterine prolapse can be caused because of congenital laxity of the tissue, number one. Generally, it occurs in women who have multiple childbearing history, that is those who have got 5 or more children. Then in the olden days, we used to see a lot of women with prolapse who have had normal deliveries, who have had traumatic deliveries, who have had prolonged labor, who has been straining in the labor room for a long period of time. Then the ligaments don't go back to their original shape and size, and then these are the things which can cause prolapse. Or women who do not have enough rest after delivery, who start lifting heavy weights. People who have chronic conditions like constipation, chronic cough, allergic cough. Now these are the people, that is whenever people are having conditions which cause consistent raised intra-abdominal pressure, that is the pressure in the abdomen keeps on raising, they can cause prolapse. Prolapse symptoms, generally most often they have something whenever they go to pee or whenever they go to the toilet, when they wash, they feel that there is something coming out. This is the first sign symptom. And sometimes they are unable to pass urine, so they have to reduce the mass, only then they'll be able to pass urine. Some people complain that they want to go to pass motion, but when they sit in the toilet, they're not able to empty totally. Then they have to go second time. So difficulty in emptying the bladder, difficulty in emptying the bowel, or sometimes mass coming between the legs and inconveniencing them while walking. Now these are the, sometimes they have discharge because the uterus is outside, the cervix is exposed to the environment, and then because of the continuous friction there will be ulcers, and then they start having discharge, they start having bleeding, and then they come with these complaints. But unfortunately most women feel very shy to say that there is something coming out, that they just ignore it, they don't tell their family members, and then unless it becomes so severe everything comes out, and then they are unable to walk, and that is when they come and tell their family members that they are having a problem, and then they come to us. Uterine prolapse, if it is only first degree prolapse, that is if the uterus and cervix are still inside the vagina and if there is no bladder descent and a bowel descent along with the uterus, then some amount of Kegels exercise and exercises to tighten the pelvic floor muscles, which are regularly taught in our physio department. So we test the tone of the muscles, and then we can give them exercises depending upon the tone, and slowly increase the tone so that the uterus does not descend further forward, and it can also improve their bowel and bladder tone, and then they'll be able to empty their bladder and bowel easily. So this is physiotherapy. We give lot of exercises, and if they are suffering from chronic constipation, or if they are having allergy or chronic cough like asthma, all these primary conditions should be treated first. So if those conditions are treated, if their intra-abdominal pressure does not rise too much, then at least we can arrest the further descent, and along with exercise we can prevent further problems and probably give them a better quality life. But if the uterus is coming out of the vagina, or if it is complete prolapse procedentia, then it is very difficult to give a medical management. But if in case they are not able to come for surgery, then pessary treatment can be given. We teach them how to reduce the mass to prevent ulceration, and then we also give them pessaries to keep things in place, at least as a temporary measure to avoid a surgery during this COVID season. Yeah, as I already told you, whenever there is a chronic condition like as a constipation, bronchial asthma, chronic cough, get them treated at the earliest. Don't ignore them. That is number one. And during pregnancy, go for regular physiotherapy classes, do your exercise properly so that the tone of the pelvic floor and the ligaments and the muscles are all maintained well. And generally in India, when a woman sets into labor, the family members have the habit of telling the woman to keep pushing the baby even before complete dilatation. So pushing the fetus, trying to push the baby even before complete dilatation has to be totally avoided. And after delivery also, during delivery also, giving a good pelvic support, perineal support, bringing out the baby in a comfortable way is very important. We can cut short the second stage of labor by applying forceps or vacuum so that the pelvic floor muscles are not totally strained out. Then we also, after delivery also, a woman has to do regular pelvic floor exercises to regain the tone of the muscle and regain the tone of the ligaments. And even whenever there is a slightest change, whenever they feel that there is some laxity, slightest laxity, if they are able to visit the doctor without feeling shy, exercises can be done and we can stop the further progress of the descent for a long period of time. Overall, what I would suggest is keep a close watch on your health. See for the slightest changes that happen to you, be it bleeding problem, be it a descent, be it any change in the breast tissue or anything. Do not neglect, do not ignore, but don't get overly anxious also. Don't become paranoid, don't become obsessive. Look after yourself, perform social distancing, use your mask, do your sanitization, and keep yourself safe and healthy. Look after yourself. If in case you need us, we are always there to help you. Look after yourself.